chief guest of today, Dr. Rajiv Kumar, former vice chairman of the NITI Aayog. Our guest of honor, Professor Agarwal, chairman of the National Board of Accreditation. Dr. Chaturvedi, Mr. Palaniveel, executive secretary. Directors of business schools, other professors, moderators, and ladies and gentlemen, very good morning to you. It's an important occasion today when we are going to hear the chief guest, guest of honor, and also a number of senior professors of the country who are going to talk to us on the reimagining of the Indian business education in the post-pandemic world. Of course, we have four sessions. Ultimately, I feel it should be called more a management education than a business education, because it's not only private business, those who study is going to manage. They are going to take care of industries. They are going to take care of government, public sector, and ultimately the economy of the country. So I feel that it is more deals with the economic development rather than finding a job. Of course, that's also very important. But the problem in our country is we give them good theory, but they lack practical knowledge. Still, the academia and the industry, still we have not come together. It is time now that we resolve this problem. There are thousands of business schools. In fact, I don't know, probably Chaturvedi may know the number of schools producing both bachelor's and master's, BBA as well as MBA. And I want all of them to be qualified to handle any situation. That is in the hands of the management, and they should be exposed to practical problems, industrial problems, government problems, whatever it is. Our Honorable Prime Minister wants India to reach $10 trillion, the GDP of India. And at present, we are in the 3.2 or 3.3 trillion. So it means that we have to grow three times, and the responsibility is more on those who study management and business, because they are the people who are going to manage everything, whether it's private sector or public sector. As it is, if you take the total GDP of the country, we are fifth in the world, next only to US, China, Japan, and Germany. But when you take the per capita income, our ranking is 144 because of the huge population and also increasing inequality in the country. Our per capita income is $2,300. Of course, it is overall average, but India is divided into two, the poor India and the rich India. Probably we won't discuss this outside, because the poor Indians earn about $1,000 to $1,500. The rich Indians earn more than US, $75,000. That's why the inequality is one of the maximum inequal country economy in the world. Probably the only competitor of us is Russia. How are we going to achieve this? As it is, we are growing. We have all the opportunities to grow. And of course, the students who study management, those who are practicing, they have to help the economy to grow. It's not only individual business, but as a country we have to grow. And each individual states have to grow. It's not only government of India, it is individual states. For example, even though the per capita income is $2,300, if you pay state-wise, there are number of states who are less than the national average, and there are some states who are above the national average. The big states like Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, their per capita income less than $1,000. Unless they also come up, the nation cannot grow. So these are certain points I would like you to bear this in mind. And especially the youngsters must be aware of this. When somebody is fighting for his survival, especially in the pandemic period, he was unable to earn even 10,000, 15,000 a month, losing his job. There are other side who earn thousands of crores a day. These are all happening in our own country. How are you going to resolve them? With all this, we must grow. Because as it is, we have a possibility of overtaking Germany and Japan to become the third largest economy of the world. They say if we may grow to 8.5 trillion, but our Prime Minister wants us to go to 10 trillion by 2030. Is it possible? And what are the problems we face? We always talk about the management, those talk about SWOT analysis: strength, weakness, opportunity, and threat. Our strength is our young population, the demographic dividend, otherwise called. Because there are countries in the world, a number of countries, 50 to 60 countries, where the population is declining, and especially they have less youngsters than those who receive pension. Take, for example, Japan. That's a major problem. How are we going to take advantage of this situation? So far, the government has not taken any initiative, either the state government or the central government, to find out what is the need of those countries, what kind of training they expect, what kind of people they expect to work there. It is possible to resolve our problem if the government also helps us. In fact, I was thinking whether we can take the initiative as EPSI, we can take the initiative. Of course, without the government help, we cannot do this. If they help us, then we will find out what are the areas where our youngsters can go and work. For example, my own students, VIT students, are working in 84 countries now. We train them some foreign languages plus other skills, whatever is required by the companies. But as a government, if you are going to get the Ministry of External Affairs and the Ministry of Education together, we can find out the vacancies available in various countries and send our youngsters there. We have enough people who study in Lakhs together, and we have to find a placement for them. As it is, ourselves also to grow. Our manufacturing sector, we are lagging behind. In the manufacturing, we contribute only 3% of the world, whereas China contributes nearly 28-29%. So there is a lot to improve in the manufacturing, where I would very much like the union government, state governments, and the private sector put together. We have to take up manufacturing, and slowly we should cut down the imports. That's what our Prime Minister says, make in India. We have been telling this for a long time. In fact, I remember when I was in Parliament, Indira Gandhi, Prime Minister, used to say same thing in a different import substitution. She used to call it import substitution. Present our Prime Minister calls it make in India. If we had taken up in the 70s, by this time we would have cut down most of the imports of the country. Even now, every year we have about 100 billion trade deficit, what we export and what we import. Unless we bridge that gap, we can never grow to that extent where we expect it to grow. And we have problems. No doubt, as I told you, we have the youngsters, enough youngsters to work. But our democracy has to be strengthened and the election process has to change. Recently we had elections, local body elections in Tamil Nadu. I find they have overtaken the assembly election, the parliament election in paying the voters. I have never seen in any part of the world selling and buying of votes. What kind of democracy we have? And what will be the future of this democracy? Poor and middle class people can never contest election because you will have to spend in crores. This is the kind of country we have, and we have to see that these things are changed. And we have certain things which are common among all of us. Take for example corruption, which is there throughout. What have we done to remove it or even to reduce it? Black money and tax evasion is almost there in every house, almost whoever earns. We have not done anything to remove it. Even you don't talk about it. And this inequality will be dangerous to our democracy. Because if somebody goes on earning at others' cost, no doubt the country grows, but the benefits of the growth should reach all. Now it is not going. Only a few, a small percentage of the population. These are the things I want the youngsters to know and work towards it. Of course, the responsibility is more of the federal government and the state governments. They have to work together. And the business schools, the responsibility is that we must have good teachers where we have a problem. To get good teachers is a real problem. And of course, infrastructure, some of us have good infrastructure, some of us do not. The one thing common to all of us is practical knowledge. In fact, many of them don't visit the factories or wherever manufacturing takes place, business houses, unless we come together, the industries on one side and the business schools on the other side. It will be difficult for them to get practical knowledge. These are the things we are going to discuss throughout. There are many professors who are well-versed in this subject. They are going to talk to us. I would like to thank our chief guest, Dr. Rajiv Kumar, with his vast experience, who has agreed to be with us, and Dr. Agarwal, with his experience for so many years, is going to talk to us. I would like to thank them, especially for accepting our invitation. Thank you very much.